Hey everyone, welcome to First Medina. We're so excited to have you here with us this morning. If you're new, thank you for being here. Be sure to head over to our website at firstmedina.org/info and fill out a connection card so we can get to know you a little better and pray for you too. One thing we truly value here at First is community. So whether today is your first time or this has been your church for years, there are multiple ways that you can connect with us and others. If you're a parent, you can get your kids involved in our children's ministry and youth ministry, which takes place every Sunday morning. We have support groups and prayer groups that meet weekly as well. If you came prepared to give today, there are two ways you can do that. You can place your gift directly in one of the boxes at the doors, or you can also give online. We're excited to continue our series, Say It Because You Mean It, this morning, and we hope that you encounter the Lord and feel His presence in a special way during our time together. Have a great day.
Welcome. Good morning. It's good to see you all. I hope you all had a safe, healthy, and blessed Thanksgiving. Now that Thanksgiving is over, you know what that means? We are allowed to listen to Christmas music now. So please stand to your feet and sing Joy to the World with us.
And makes the nations prove. Good morning. Happy Thanksgiving. I know it's over, but happy Thanksgiving. It is such an awesome day to celebrate our Savior, Jesus Christ. We just sang a song that's called a Christmas song, but it's not really a Christmas song. It's really about the time when Jesus comes again. And when he comes again, he's going to establish his kingdom on earth. He rules the world with truth and grace. No more let tears or sorrows grow. That's what's the change that's going to take place. That's what we're celebrating when we think about Jesus Christ, the King of the world. And we can celebrate that all year round. I know this is Christmas season, and that's the time when we sing this song, but in particular. That's what we can celebrate together today. Let's pray together, and let's turn our hearts to God and focus on that praise. God, we want to celebrate the fact that you are an amazing, awesome, wonderful, powerful God. We want to thank you that we can have confidence in the future. We know what's going to happen because we know who you are. You've overcome sin and death. And the struggles that we face in this world, we're not going to face one day, because you're going to be seated on the throne. And we celebrate that. So God, today, a great day to celebrate. Would you just take my heart and open up my heart to you and make me ready to see you for who you are and to bow my heart before you and say, okay, Jesus, you're in charge. I love you. I'll follow you wherever you want me to go to do whatever you want me to do. God, empower us to praise you, I pray.
My heart. Trust you, how I prove in my Father, we thank you so much for Jesus. We thank you for his healing, cleansing blood. We thank you that Jesus is our Savior and our friend. We just thank you so much for your faithfulness and that we can trust you. I've seen that in my life over and over. And I pray that everyone here would be able to see that, to feel that, to know that you are faithful and you are trustworthy. And I pray that as we sing this next song, Father, that you would be glorified. It would be a sweet sound to your ear. We pray this in Jesus' name.
I will. God, we thank you that you are ruling, you are on the throne. You are marvelous, glorious. There are so many names we can attribute to you. Thank you that you are the light of the world. Thank you that you know us intimately. We're so thankful that you sent your son Jesus to die for us on the cross, to be buried and risen on the third day. Thank you for the promise of eternal life if we just believe in him. Time here this morning, we ask that it would be a time of reflection in our own hearts, a time of celebration, a time of remembering things in our lives that we need to turn over to you, reminding ourselves of how you've been faithful. Thank you that you are faithful and you are good. In Jesus' name, amen. You can have a seat, everybody.
Morning to everybody. Isn't it just beautiful outside? How many love the snow this morning? Wow, you are more snow bunnies than the first group. First group were kind of like, no, there were people there that liked it too. There were people there that liked it too. Let's go ahead and start with a word of prayer. Father, I thank you for your love. I thank you for that. I pray, God, as we get into your word this morning, that you'll open our hearts to you. I pray, God, that it'll be more than just a message of words, but it'll be something that'll help our lives change, something that'll help us to be able to do what you'd have us to do with our lives. Please change our hearts, Father, to make us more like Christ today. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. We are in Acts going through, say it because you mean it. You ever stop to think about that? Say it because you mean it. When you really mean something, do you say it different than just saying it? Like, it's a nice day out there. Did that sound like I really meant it? But if sun was shining and it was 75 degrees and the birds were singing, I said, it's a great day out there. It's a little bit different, isn't it? As we study through the book of Acts, we think about saying it like we mean it. That's what the apostles did. They said it like they meant it. Message that God gave to them to deliver to the people. He actually gave them marching orders. We're going to be in Acts chapter 5 today. So if you have your Bible with you or your iPhone or whatever device you're using to look up the scripture, turn to Acts chapter 5. Acts chapter 5. Marching orders. Marching orders are something that comes from the commander-in-chief, right? Gives it to you before you get ready to go in the field to fight the battle. Because he wants you to accomplish great things. He gives you those orders. Jesus did that. He'd been with the disciples for over 3 years. And he was getting ready to leave them physically on this earth. And he wanted to leave them with something. So he gave them marching orders. Let's go ahead and let's turn to Matthew chapter 28, verses 18 through 20. This is what it says there. And Jesus came and said to them, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. Sounds a lot like marching orders, doesn't it? The commander-in-chief, the guy with supreme authority, Jesus Christ, all authority was given to him by his Father over everything. And with that authority, he was telling his people what he wanted them to do, his disciples, what he wanted them to do. What was it that he wanted them to do? He wanted them to go into the world and make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. That's what he wanted them to do. And in addition to that, he wanted them to teach them. He wanted to teach them everything that he told them to observe so that they could live the lives that he wanted to be. And there's something that's very special about this particular commander-in-chief. Unlike many on this earth who will give you the orders and then go back to the office and sit down and prop the feet up, this one says, I'm going to be with you every step of the way as we go through this world. doing the marching orders I've given to you, I'm going to be with you. It's interesting, last week Pastor Kurt was finishing up and talking about Ananias and Sapphira. And I have to stop to think about that. What would happen here if something like that happened? I mean, Pastor Kurt, if somebody walked into your office, let's say they walked in and said, you know, we had this property and we sold it for $50,000. It was Shelton here. Shelton was the one that did it. He walked in. Sure. He walked in and he said, you know, we sold it, my wife and I, we sold this property for $50,000. And you said, you know, I have it from the authority of the Holy Ghost that you actually sold her for $75,000 and they fell over dead. What do you think? How would that play out? What would happen here in the church? What would people think about this place? I mean, you go to see the pastor and you fall over dead. I mean, that's kind of interesting. It would have an effect, right? It had an effect. Let's go ahead and let's look at Acts chapter 5. We're going to start in verse 12. What was going on in the church? Because this was right after that happened. What was happening in the church. In verse 12 it says, now many signs and wonders were regularly done among the people by the hands of the apostles. And they were all together in Solomon's portico. None of the rest dared join them, but the people held them in high esteem. And more than ever, believers were added to the Lord, multitudes of both men and women. God was working in special ways at this time. He was starting the church. There's one thing about miracles. When God changes direction on things, he always seems to have extra miracles that are going on. Think about when he created the world. There are a lot of miracles there. Think about when they got out of Egypt. There was a lot of miracles there. Think about when the prophets started teaching and the miracles that happened there when they first started. Think about the miracles that Jesus did. There's big changes coming. There was lots of miracles because God wanted to get people's attention. And the easiest way to do that is to do something they're not used to seeing. People were coming to see these guys because whoever came to see them that was sick was healed. Every single one of them. I don't know if they were all saved. I don't know if they all became Christians, but he healed them all. But you know, God heals everybody, right? Anybody that gets healed, it's God that does it, whether they're Christians or not. He does heal people. So he was healing all these people. And it got people's attention. And how did they respond to that? How would you respond to it? Like, let's say that there was a team of men that came up on the stage here, and week after week they were giving messages, and everybody that came in with physical infirmities were completely healed. What do you think would happen? How do you think the community would react to that? This place would be packed out, right? It would be totally packed out because people were coming and they were addressing the needs of the people. There's a little bit of a pattern there that we might want to think about. You address the needs of the people and share the gospel and see what kind of effect it has on the community. But what effect did it have on the church? Well, first of all, it brought them together. There was nobody that joined them that wasn't a true believer. If you visit the pastor, you end up, would you really want to join that group? Unless you were a true believer. So it brought them together. There was unity with it, as it tells us in verse 12. Verse 13, they were magnified. People held them in high esteem. These were real, genuine people. They weren't phony. They weren't fake. Because the phony, fake people don't fare very well. So the people that stay there do. And they were esteemed for that. People thought a lot of them. And because of that, multitudes of both men and women were joined. They were multiplied. They grew. They grew an awful lot. That's what happened in that church. And that's how it was acting. And that's what was going on. And how did the community react to all of this? Starting in verse 15. But so that they even carried on the sick into the streets and laid them on cots and mats, that as Peter came by, at least his shadow might fall on some of them. The people also gathered from the towns around Jerusalem, bringing the sick and those affected for unclean spirits, and they were healed. Yeah, it got their attention. People were coming. People were coming in droves. They even started adding little things like, well, let's place people a certain place, and Peter's shadow will fall on them, and they might get healed. You know, I don't know if that happened or not. I do know that when the lady grabbed Jesus' hem. She was healed of the blood issue. But I do know that people were drawn to them in droves to hear about what was going on. You know, you think everybody would be excited about that, right? I mean, just think about it. If you knew that everybody that came to the first Medina that had their infirmity, some type of physical, mental, whatever, and they were healed and their lives were changed, what do you think would happen? Everybody would be excited, right? Well, if everybody that came here got healed, how do you think Medina Hospital would feel about that? I mean, hopefully they would be happy and they would be excited. But, you know, it would kind of dry up their revenue stream, right? They'd go out of business. So they may not really like it. This is what's happening. All the people are turning and going to these guys instead of somebody in particular. And the somebody in particular is a fellow by the high priest. Because you need to understand, the high priest is the man. If you want healed, you want fixed, you want anything to take care of your life, I'm the one that you come to see. So how did he feel about it? Well, he had the apostles arrested. Let's look in verse 17. But the high priest rose up, and all were with him, that is, the party of the Sadducees, and filled with jealousy, they arrested the apostles and put them in the public prison. He didn't like it a bit. I mean, you're taking away my business. These are my people. What are you doing? You're drawing them away from me. I'm the main man here. Not this Jesus character you're talking about. I am. It's me. He didn't like it. So he got some guys to come along with him, the Sadducees. The Sadducees, by the way, don't believe in the resurrection. And these guys were talking about a resurrection. So he figured this group of men would help strengthen his argument because they would present the side that there is no resurrection of the body or of people. So he brought them with him. And he put them in a regular jail. The reason they did that is because these are just common criminals. You people think there's something fabulous, there's something great because of all these wonderful things you're doing? The reality is they're nothing. They're just common criminals. So they put them in that prison. And that's what happened. Something happened that night. The apostles were freed and given marching orders. These are additional marching orders to what Jesus gave originally. These are a little more detailed. But during the night, an angel of the Lord opened the prison doors and brought them out and said, "Go and stand in the temple and speak to the people all the words of life." And what was the response of the apostles? And when they heard this, they entered the temple at daybreak and began to teach. That doesn't make sense. I mean, think about it. You just busted out of jail. Are you going to go stand in a public place? Or are you going to hightail it out of town? I mean, I'd hightail it out of town. I don't want to be arrested again. But they had marching orders from God. And they decided they were going to do what God told them to do. They weren't afraid. They moved forward because they had God on their side. And what was it that they were supposed to teach? All the words of life, of this life specifically. Of this life. What life were they talking about? What was it that the marching orders that this angel gave to them that they were supposed to do? What were they supposed to share with people? This is a Christian life. Where do you start? Where do you begin? When you have an opportunity to share the gospel, where do you start? What do you start with? It's an interesting question, isn't it? Well, let's look at Scripture and see what it tells us. Let's look at Romans chapter 10, verses 8 through 10. But what does it say? The word is near to you in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith that we proclaim. Because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For the heart one believes and is justified, with the mouth one confesses and is saved. So where does it start? It starts with Jesus. It starts with figuring out who he is. Who is this guy, Jesus? He's the Lord. He's God. He's over everything. That's where you start. People need to understand who he is. So an explanation, explain to him, that's who he is. He's the one that's in charge of absolutely everything. A lot of people don't understand that. They don't know who he is. And it may take some time to go through that and help them to understand that. But that's where you start. Who is Jesus? And one of the important things that you need to believe about him is that he came to earth, died on a cross, and rose from the dead for us. Jesus didn't do this for his convenience. He did it for us. God himself died and rose from the dead for us. That's where you start. And who's it for? Is it for us, or is it just for this group over here or that group over there? Let's look at John 3:16 and 17. We're going to have verses today that you guys are going to be very familiar with. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. So, who did Jesus come for? Everybody. There's not a single person that Jesus didn't die for. I mean, sit there and think for a minute. Is there somebody that I know that Jesus probably didn't die for? Is there? Not to everybody. Every single person he died for. That's why he came into this world. And that's what he came that first time for. You know, the priests and the leaders, they wanted them to come and get rid of the Romans. They wanted to condemn all the bad that they're doing and set them up and they could help him rule this world. But that wasn't Jesus' plan when he came the first time. He came into the world to save the world, not to condemn it. That was his whole purpose. Jesus, God, that's who he is. Died on a cross, rose from the dead, and he did it for everybody. Everybody. Everybody needs to hear this message, and that's what these apostles were shedding. So how does it work? Ephesians 2:8 through 10. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and not of yourselves, it is a gift of God. Not of works, lest anybody should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared before that we should walk in them. Grace. Grace is when you get something that you shouldn't get. You don't deserve it. That's what God did. His son, God, died on a cross, rose from the dead for everybody by grace. So how do you receive that? How do you receive this gift? It's called faith. You trust God. You trust God to do what he says he's going to do. If you trust me, I'll save you. We know the particulars because it's laid out here. And this is the marching orders of the disciples. This is what they were supposed to share with the people. By the way, this is part of the marching orders for us. We all have marching orders. Each and every person in this room has marching orders. Do you know that? If you're a Christian, you have marching orders because Jesus set them up for you. I'm going to tell you something flat out. I don't know what they are. I don't have a clue. I know some principles and some basic things, but your particular marching orders, I don't know. But I can tell you where you can find them. You can find them in God's Word. They're there. All you got to do is look for them. Now, let me tell you a little secret. When you go to God's Word asking a question, be prepared for Him not to show you right away. He's too excited that you're in his word. He said, man, I finally got this person in my word. I'm going to get him. I'm going to show him this. I'm going to show him that. No, don't look there yet. I want you to hear it. And he takes you through all this stuff. He's so excited that you're there. Now, eventually, he'll answer your question. But it's going to take effort on your part. And you're going to have to stick with it. You're going to have to keep looking. But it's there. If you have any interest in finding out what your marching orders are, look in the book. Because they're there. And like I said, be prepared to have to dig. It's not because he's trying to be hard on you. He's just excited that you're there. It's like you invite somebody over to your house. You set them in a corner and hand them a sandwich and say, have a nice day. No, you get involved with each other. You talk, you converse, you share, you fellowship, you do all that stuff. That's what God's going to do when you get into his word. So do it. But only if you're interested in finding out what your marching orders are. If you're not interested, don't bother. Okay? What happened? He saved us. This is in Titus chapter 3, verse 5. He saved us. We know that. Not because of works that we've done by his righteousness. We also know that. but according to his own mercy, by the washing and regeneration and renewing of the Holy Spirit. He saved us by washing us, making us clean, renewing us, whom he poured out on us richly through Jesus Christ our Lord, our Savior, so that being justified by grace, we might become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. So what happens? You're heirs. You're heirs. Did you know that? You are going to inherit heaven. That's what it tells us here. What happened? When Jesus, when God came to this earth, died on a cross, rose from the dead for everybody, and you believe that, you become heirs of heaven. You become heirs of heaven. So what's the purpose? Let's look at 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 15 and 17. He died for all, we know that, that those who live might no longer live for themselves. Is that slightly different than human nature? Maybe just a little bit? What's our nature? I live for myself. It's all about me. Didn't you know that? And there was a point in my life when that changed. By the way, that is exactly the way it was. But when I realized that Jesus is God, that he came to earth and he died on a cross, that he rose from the dead, he did it for everybody, including me, and it's a free gift from grace, and all I have to do is put my faith in him, it changed. It changed. We no longer live for themselves, but for him who for their sake died and was raised. From now on, therefore, we regard no one according to the flesh. Even though we once regarded Christ according to the flesh, we regard him thus no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away, but behold, the new has come. The purpose is to make you brand new. You're not like you used to be. When you become a Christian, you're not. And most everybody in this room knows that because I know a lot of the people in here and you're Christians. I see it in your life. So you know that. You're not what you used to be. And that's a good thing. Because how were we before? We were selfish. It's all about me. But God changed that. He changed that in his life. And how does it work out? Let's look at Titus chapter 2, starting verse 11. For the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all people. We know that. Training. Do you know that you're in a training program? You didn't even have to sign up for it. God put you in it. What's this training program consist of? Trials, tribulations, hard to get along with people. Things that you don't like. This book, getting together, sharing with Christian friends, talking about God, sharing with other people. These are all training sessions. There are training sessions to accomplish something. What is it that they're to accomplish? To renounce ungodliness and worldly possessions and to be live self-controlled life. It's hard to live a self-controlled life. Self-control right away says it's hard, right? Is self-control hard? Sure it is. Because if we were not self-controlled, what happens to us? Very quickly, it's all about me. It takes effort. And you have to be controlled to be able to do that. Upright and godly lives in this present age. This isn't for when we get to heaven. This is now. This is how God wants you to live now. See, you have to understand, eternal life begins the day that you get saved, not the day that you die. You get that, right? It starts the day that you get saved. From that moment on, you're stuck with living forever with God. It's a good thing. It's not a bad thing. It's a good thing. But it starts that day, and God's working on you, training on you, and working on with you to help develop you into the person that's fit to be in heaven. Without salvation, we're not fit to be in heaven, right? We're not. It's Christ's shed blood that makes us fit for heaven, nothing we've done. Who gave himself for us to redeem us from lawlessness and to purify for himself a people for his own possession who are zealous for good works. Zealous for good works. Do you get excited about doing things for God? Does it make your heart kind of thump? I can be doing stuff for God today. What? I wonder what God's got me to do today. I'm just so excited. I can't wait to do it. Do we have that attitude toward it? Do you understand your marching orders? Are you excited to do them? If you're not, don't worry about it. The reason I tell you not to worry about it, because God's got you in a training program. And you will be. I've got good news for you. God loves you too much not to have you turn out well. Did you hear that? God loves you too much to not have you turn out well. He's not going to let you mess around. He's going to work on you until this is you. This is the life. This is the life that the apostles were told to teach the people. Jesus is God. He's in charge. Whatever he says goes, period. He came to earth, died on a cross, rose from the dead for everybody, including me. And all I have to do is trust him, put my faith in him. And I receive that. And God's going to make me a new creature. This is what we can all say. He's going to make us new creatures so that we can accomplish the work that he's given for us to do, our marching orders, the things that he has for us to do. This is the message that these guys were doing. By the way, not everybody liked these messages, remember? Remember the high priest? We're going to have an expression, meanwhile, back at the Sanhedrin. In the old days, the cowboys used to say, meanwhile, back at the OK Corral. What's going on with these guys? Well, here's these guys. They got busted out of jail. Sanhedrin doesn't even know that. By the way, who is the Sanhedrin? It's a group of 70 men. Really smart guys, by the way. Very well learned in the law. As a matter of fact, they have to memorize the law by the time they're 13. And they have to memorize the whole rest of the Old Testament by the time they're 30. So these guys are not dummies. They're smart. They're intelligent men. They missed Christ, but these are really sharp guys. And it's not only them on this particular day. It's also the ones that they invited, the Senate and the council they brought with them, which was another 40, 50 guys. So there was well over 100 men in this meeting that were coming together to figure out what to do with these apostles. Remember, they're thinking these guys are sitting in jail. They're not. They're out doing their marching orders. So let's take a look and see what's going on here. Now when the high priest came and those who were with him, they called together the council, all the senate of the people of Israel, and sent to the prison to have them brought. But when the officers came, they did not find them in prison. So they returned and reported, "We found the prison securely locked and the guards standing at the doors. But when we opened, we found nothing, no one inside." Now when the captain of the temple and the chief priest heard these words, they were greatly perplexed about them, wondering what they should do would come to this. And someone came and told them, "Look, the men whom you put in prison are standing in the temple and teaching the people." Yeah, the angel busted him out. He must have closed the door behind him. He probably said to the last apostle, "Shut the door." Because the doors were locked. Nobody even knew they were gone. They went to the temple, and they did what God had told them to do. Well, the high council didn't want anything to do with that, so they figured we got to take these guys into custody again. So they sent the captain of the guard. Verse 26, "Then the captain with his officers went and brought them, but not by force, for they were afraid of being stoned by the people." Sure they were. People loved them. Lives were being changed. Sick people were made well. People were there having problems, no longer having problems when they came to these guys. If this place was packed out with people that had all those things happening to them, and a handful of men come in and says, "Hey, we're arresting these guys and hauling them off," what do you think would happen? Might get a little ugly, huh? Now, you aren't taking these guys. Look what they're doing for us, and you want to arrest them? So the apostles did something that I don't understand. They went. They said, "Yeah, we'll go with you." I mean, like I said, me, I said, "No, I'm staying here." But they went. Verse 27, and when they brought them, they sent them before the council. And the high priest questioned them, saying, we strictly charge you not to teach in this name. It's the name of Jesus. Yet you have filled Jerusalem with your teaching, and you intend to bring this man's blood upon us. We told you not to do this. What are you doing? We told you not to. And we find you out there doing it. And this guy, Jesus, you're trying to pin it on us. He's murdered. That's kind of interesting. I think back to Matthew chapter 27, verse 25. If you're not familiar with that particular passage, it has to do with Pilate. Pilate's washing his hands and is saying, I'm innocent of this man's blood. And what do the people cry out? His blood be upon us and our children. It's interesting how things can change over time. They don't want to be associated with that at all. But they are. So when Peter talks about them killing him, he's telling the truth. This is Peter's response starting in verse 29. But Peter and the apostles answered, we must obey God rather than men. The God of our fathers raised Jesus, whom you killed by hanging him on a tree. God exalted him in his right hand as leader and savior to give repentance to Israel and forgiveness for sins. And we are witnesses to these things. And so is the Holy Ghost, whom God has given to those who obey him. We've got our marching orders from God. We've got our marching orders from the commander-in-chief. That you're put in place, God put you in place, and I need to listen to you, and I need to do the things that you're telling me, unless it contradicts what the commander-in-chief said. The commander-in-chief said he gave us marching orders that we go and we preach and teach in this name of Jesus. So we're going to do that. And this Jesus, by the way, the one that you guys killed, the one that you hung on a tree, by the way, in that society and in the Old Testament times, if somebody was hung in a tree, that the idea was they're cursed by God. Cursed by God. He said, God didn't curse them. God exalted him. God lifted him up. Made him the leader or prince, as some versions will say, and our savior to lead Israel to repentance and to pay for our sins. He's got to, what do you mean pay for our sins? We're not sinners. You remember, these are self-righteous leaders. Yeah, you have to understand that. What do you mean pay for our sins? Maybe yours, but not ours. We don't have any sins. They were totally blind, totally blind to what was going on. And they knew it because they were witnesses. And not only them, but those that chose to become followers. Because the Holy Spirit revealed it to them so that they knew it was real and true. One of the things about spiritual truth, once the Holy Spirit indwells you, it's there, spiritual truth. You know it. You know stuff you don't even realize you know. And when it's appropriate, God will bring it to your attention. But it's the Holy Spirit that reveals that. And these people knew that this Jesus was God, that he came to earth, died on a cross, rose from the dead, did it for everybody, we accepted for the faith so that we could be changed people, so that we could be zealous for his works. They knew it because of what the Holy Spirit had told them. So how did they respond? When they heard this, they were enraged and they wanted to kill them. I can imagine. They'd start, you know, in that society, they just start ripping their clothes and pulling out their beard and yanking out their hair, just screaming, fighting back and forth. Because they couldn't argue with it because it was the truth. There's one thing about the truth. It's really difficult to get people that don't want to believe it to act any other way than insane. They'll do anything, they'll say anything to prove that the truth is not right. Even if it makes no sense. Because they have to defend their position. So that's where these guys were. What do we do? God's provision for protection comes from an unusual place. It actually comes from the Sanhedrin. Starting in verse 34, but a Pharisee in the council named Gamaliel, a teacher of the law, held in honor by all the people, stood up and gave orders to put the men outside for a little while. And he said to them, men of Israel, take care what you're about to do to these men. For before these days, Theudas rose up, claiming to be somebody, and a number of men, about 400, joined him. He was killed, and all who followed him were dispersed and came to nothing. After him, Judas the Galilean rose up in the days of the census and drew away some of the people after him. He too perished, and all who followed him were scattered. So in the present case, I tell you, keep away from these men and let them alone. For if this plan or this undertaking is of man, it will fail. But if it is God, you will not be able to overthrow them. You might even be found to oppose God. So they took his advice. Was it good advice? Suggesting one remain neutral to Jesus or just ignore him is always bad. Always bad. But even so, God used this advice to protect his own, to protect his children. But for these men, it was bad advice. They were told, just ignore him. He'll go away. And oh, by the way, if he is from God, it doesn't matter. You're going to be okay anyhow. So many people feel that they can make a decision about Jesus or not make a decision about Jesus, and they're going to be okay. That's not true. That is not true. If you choose to ignore Jesus, if you choose to not make him part of your life, you are not going to be okay. You're not. If there's anybody in this room that has not accepted Christ as your Savior, you need to understand you will not be okay. It does not end well for you. So if somebody says, listen to it, make your mind up, and if you decide it's hogwash, don't pay any attention to it, it's not okay. Not okay. That's why it was bad advice. But God did use it to protect his own, because they didn't kill him, but they did do something to them. Let's look at what it says in verse 40, serving in joy. And when they had called the apostles, they beat them and charged them not to speak in the name of Jesus and let them go. Then they left the presence of the council, rejoicing that they were counted worthy to suffer dishonor for his name. And every day in the temple and from house to house, they did not cease teaching and preaching that Christ is Jesus, the anointed. That's what Christ means. Jesus, the Savior. The anointed Savior is Jesus. They didn't stop. They were beaten. 39 lashes. Think about it. It had to hurt. There's that whip dug into their back. Even if they had their coats on, which they didn't, they stripped them down and they beat them. I can imagine them screaming in agony and pain. What had happened? I would. If somebody took a whip to you, would you start screaming after a while? I mean, 39 lashes is a lot. And then when they put their coats on to leave and their fabric's rubbing against the open wounds, it's got to hurt. And their response? They were joyful that they were found worthy to suffer as Christ had suffered. They rejoiced. They didn't enjoy getting beat, but they rejoiced that God had saw them in a way that they thought they were worthy to suffer as Jesus had suffered. And they found joy in that. Let's look at 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 12. Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery trial when it comes upon you to test you, as though something strange was happening to you. But rejoice insofar as you share Christ's sufferings, that you may also rejoice and be glad when his glory is revealed. When Jesus comes back, if you have suffered for sharing the good news of Jesus Christ, if you suffered for that, you will be lifted up and God will be glorified. You will be honored and God will be glorified. We've not had anything happen like this in this country yet. We've enjoyed the last 200 years. I hope we have another 1,000 years like that in this country. I wouldn't want to go through this. But if it changes, don't be surprised. Don't be surprised. They don't want to hear it. They don't want to hear about Jesus. And their frustration, they do crazy things like beat you and kill you and destroy you. But it's okay, because when Jesus comes back, and he is coming back, right? He is coming back. You will be lifted up and honored because of the suffering that you did. And God will be glorified. God will be glorified. Let's see what it says in 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 12. I thank him who has given me strength, Christ Jesus our Lord, because he judged me faithful, appointing me to his service. Marching orders. Appointing you to his service. He has marching orders for you. can do them. He's going to give you the strength to do them. All we need to do is be faithful. And when we are faithful, we do carry them out. Not in our strength, but in His strength. So we don't have to worry about whether we can or we can't do it. We can. See, I understand that you can't lose with God. It doesn't make any difference whether you die. You can't lose. You're in heaven. You can't lose. He's going to be with you every step of the way. And He has marching orders. He has things that He wants you to do. And remember, each and every person in this room has marching orders. And I'll say it again. I don't know what they are. I can give you the general things. I know He wants you to share the gospel. I know He wants you to make disciples. I know He wants you to teach people. I know He wants you to teach them about the truth of this life, what God has in mind. I know that. But He has something specific that He wants you to be doing. I hope. My prayer is that you'll want to find out what it is. But you got to get in God's word for it. He will give it to you, no question. But like I said, be prepared to be there for a while. He's too happy to have you in His house. He doesn't want it to end too quickly. I mean, just think about it. Okay, God, what do you want me to do? Boom, here it is. Okay. And we'd be off on our way. Well, that didn't say anything. Well, what does this mean? I never saw that before. I never thought about this before. And He's training us. He's teaching us so that when we get our marching orders, we're ready to do them. Look for your marching orders. We all have them. And yours is specific to you. No one else. No one else. And God won't hide it from you forever. He'll teach you along the way until He gives them to you. Because when you get them, you have to be ready to carry them out. Anybody in the military here? They send you for basic training and then advanced training before you go into battle, right? That's what they do. But when you go into battle, they give you your marching orders. And that's how God works it. He trains you. He gets you ready. And we'll all be ready for it. Let's pray. Father, I thank You so much that You love us. I thank You, God, that You have something for each one of us. I pray, God, that we look forward to Your work that You have with a zealous heart, that we can't wait to do it, that our hearts thumps and jumps for joy because we know that we're doing Your work. Please, God, let that be our experience. Give us the desire to find Your marching orders for us. And when You give them to us, Father, give us the courage to carry them out. We know You're going to be with us every step of the way, but God, it's scary to take that first step until we experience You being with us. But after you do, it's such a joyful thing. I pray, God, that You'll be with each of us. Show us what You want us to do today. Show us what You want us to do tomorrow and this week and this month and this year and the years to come. Because when Your Son returns, Father, we want to be honored. So that He'll be glorified. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thank you very much for your attention. Lord willing, we'll see you next week.